When you think of all the critically important things your nervous system is responsible for doing, it's amazing to understand that much of its functioning is actually done at the cellular level. In this video, I'm going to discuss what these cells are and their functioning. The nervous system's primary job is to send and receive signals between the brain and spinal cord to all parts of the body, and then to process those messages. The two types of cells that help make this happen are glial cells and neurons. Although sources vary on the number, it's generally given as an estimate that you have about 100 billion glial cells and 100 billion neurons in your nervous system. Yes, that's billions with a B. Of course, you may see references to different numbers here and there. After all, it's an estimate since nobody is sitting down and actually counting every single cell in your nervous system. There are several different types of both glial cells and neurons. Glial cells play a role in supporting the functioning of your nervous system. There are three main types of glial cells: astrocytes, oligodendrocytes, and microglial cells. Astrocytes are mostly found in the brain and spine, also known as the central nervous system. They help provide favorable conditions, structural support, and energy for neurons. Oligodendrocytes, I'll discuss later in the video. They're found in parts of some neurons in the peripheral nervous system and help insulate and protect those neurons while also helping them to better send impulses. Microglial cells I like to think of as being like the garbage men of the central nervous system, helping to remove some of the debris and help fight infections. Just like there are different types of glial cells, there are many different types of neurons also. However, I'm not going to go into detail on all of the different types in this video. Rather, I'm going to focus on the general structure of the neurons. I'll go into some specific types of neurons in the videos covering sensation, though. So, neurons are essentially the cells that are responsible for the primary mission of the nervous system. That is to send and receive messages from the brain and spinal cord to all parts of the body, as well as within the brain. The way I like to look at it is that glial cells are kind of like the backup dancers and the neurons are like the stars of the show. The general structure of a neuron is very similar to many other cells in your body, with a few noticeable differences. Let's get started by talking about some of these general structures. So virtually every cell in your body is going to have a nucleus surrounded by cytoplasm, which is then encapsulated into a cell membrane. A good analogy that I like to think of when talking about cells is think of it like it's a chicken egg. The yummy egg yolk is the nucleus, the cytoplasm is the egg white, and the cell brain is like the shell of the egg. Hopefully that's not making anybody not want to eat eggs anymore. When we talk about neurons, this entire structure of the cell membrane, cytoplasm, and nucleus are usually referred to as being the soma. Now, the nucleus is where the DNA for the cell is kept and is critically important for keeping the cell working. This is a critically important role. However, it isn't too relevant for the way these cells help the nervous system send and receive messages, so I'm not going to talk about the nucleus. Instead, I'm going to focus on some of the parts of the neuron that make these cells unique. So, coming off the soma are branch-like extensions called dendrites. On the opposite end of the soma from the dendrites is a long tube-like structure called the axon. Where the axon meets the cell membrane is a structure called the axon hillock. Surrounding the axon on some neurons, not all of them, are collections of small little glial cells. These are the oligodendrocytes that I talked about earlier. They're also called Schwann cells. They form a collection of little bead-like structures that, to me, almost resemble pearls on a necklace. Together, this collection of Schwann cells is known as the myelin sheath. On the opposite end of the axon from the soma, we have a collection of branches called axon terminals. At the end of the axon terminals are tiny little structures called terminal buttons. From here, the axon terminals are able to make connections with neighboring neurons. On a side note, be careful on this because both structures, axon terminals and terminal buttons, can sometimes have different names applied to them depending on the source that you're looking at. Now, the way this all works is that a neuron receives a signal from a neighboring neuron that is picked up by the dendrites. This signal travels through the cell body where it builds up. Every type of neuron has a unique amount of electrical energy that must build up in order for the neuron to activate or send its signal on to another neuron. This is called the neuron's threshold of excitation. Once the amount of energy builds up to the point that it meets that threshold, then the axon hillock allows the energy to surge down the axon. Now, I always like to point out that although all of these structures I'm talking about are microscopically small, you do have axons that can be very long. In fact, humans have axons that run from your pelvis all the way down to your toes. Some animal species, like blue whales and giraffes, have axons that are much longer than that. As this electrical signal goes down the axons, the myelin sheath helps maintain the current of energy, which is called the neuron's action potential, as it continues to surge all the way down to the axon terminals. From there, it's able to be passed on to a neighboring neuron, and it'll be discussing how this happens in the video on neurotransmitters, so be sure to check that out. Now, this is largely the textbook definition of how neurons work. However, I know for many people, it can be a little confusing. I'm definitely a guy that likes to make things as easy to understand as possible, so let me share with all of you a little different way of thinking about this process that may help you out. Let's start by pretending that the whole structure is something that we're already familiar with. Now, stay with me on this because it may sound a little weird. But let's pretend that these dendrites coming off of the soma are like roads, and the electrical impulse they're receiving from neighboring neurons are just cars traveling down those roads. Since we have all these dendrites or roads meeting together in the soma, let's think of it as being like an intersection. Now, if you have a whole bunch of roads meeting at an intersection with cars traveling down them, you're going to need a traffic light to help you with maintaining that traffic flow. That's kind of what the axon hillock does. The big difference, though, is that the axon hillock will only turn from red to green when a certain number of cars are present. That's what I'm talking about with the threshold of excitation. So, say in my example, the cell has the equivalent threshold of 40 cars being present. It isn't going to turn green if there are 30 cars, 35 cars, 38 cars. However, as soon as the 40th car pulls up to that light, it will turn green and allow the cars to go surging past the intersection. Where they're all going is the axon, which you can think of as being sort of like an interstate highway. Just like highways, the axon is meant to send signals long distances with as few disruptions as possible. Of course, that's always the idea, but I feel like every time I'm on the interstate, it isn't really the case. In my example, you can think of the myelin sheath as sort of like being the guardrails for the highway. Now, just like highways have exits, so too does the axon. Also, remember that messaging in the nervous system doesn't involve just one neuron, but a connection of many neurons. So think of this like how you may drive across the country. Back roads lead to intersections that lead to highways that lead to exits, more back roads and highways and exits, and so on until you get to where you want to go. The way that one neuron connects to another neuron to send and receive messages throughout your body and nervous system can be thought of as being similar to a line of dominoes. When one falls, it triggers the next one to drop, and the action continues all the way down the line. These are known as neuropathways. There are three main types of neuropathways in your nervous system: afferent pathways, efferent pathways, and interneural pathways. Afferent pathways start in sensory cells located throughout your body and send signals towards your spinal cord and brain. Efferent pathways go from your brain to muscles to create actions. Interneural pathways operate within the brain to enable communication between the different parts of your nervous system. So if you're walking and step on a nail, the pain impulse is sent from your foot to your brain through the afferent pathway. The brain receives that message and processes it through the inner neural pathways, then sends a message to your foot through the efferent pathway. Now, I get that afferent and efferent sound very similar. Don't blame me, I didn't name them, but I do have a great way to keep them straight. Think of the A in afferent as meaning all the way to the brain, and the E in efferent as meaning exiting the brain. In closing, I do want to reiterate that what I covered in this video is a very basic overview of how the cellular structures of your nervous system work. Remember that not every neuron has all the structures or even the same shape as what I described. However, to go into greater detail about that would be well beyond the scope of a regular general psychology course, which is really kind of the point of these videos in the first place. So thanks for watching, everybody.